Our first reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 43, 16 to 21, page 62 in the Pew Dot Bible. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do you remember the former things or consider the things of old? I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drinks to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. Our epistle reading this morning is from Philippians chapter 3 on page 198 in the Pew Bible. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as lost because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as lost because of the surpassing value of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the share of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Now that I have already obtained this and have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal of the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are who are mature be of the same mind. And if you think differently about anything, this too God will reveal to you. Only let us hold fast to what we have obtained. And our gospel reading comes from John chapter 12 on page 106 in the Pew Bibles. Six days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of the costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. The gospel lesson for this Lord's Day brings us to the time in which Jesus Christ is closing out his public ministry. Immediately preceding the lesson that was read for you today, Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. In this particular lesson which we heard, Jesus was then honored at a dinner at Lazarus' house. Following this episode in the Gospel of John, Jesus will proceed from this time and this place and move towards Jerusalem to celebrate the entry, which we call Palm Sunday. At the time of Lazarus' raising from the dead, Jesus was in an agony, suffering from the idea of losing someone whom he loved. Jesus ordered the stone rolled away, and Lazarus came forth. Jesus was in the presence of a large proportion of the community. The site of this miracle was near Jerusalem, about 2 or 3 miles away. And much of Jerusalem had come out to be with Martha and Mary and to join them in their lamentation of the death of their brother. Much of the Judean community had come out, and when Jesus came and did this thing, they were stunned. They were witnesses to something powerful, something unprecedented, and it stirred up in them a reflection as to where they stood on the Jesus question. And as we know from this gospel, many changed their thinking. Many began to follow him. When news reached Jerusalem of what had happened with Lazarus, the chief priests, the priests, the scribes, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees were distressed. They were distressed because it became apparent to them that people were now even more so following Jesus. They were distressed because they realized that this could erode their power base. They were distressed because they realized that this could upset the balance of power, that frail, fragile peace that they had with the Romans. And so in response to this, they decided to conspire. They decided to conspire against Jesus. They decided to murder Jesus. They decided to murder Lazarus. In response to this miracle of God, in this profound statement that God's love in Jesus Christ transcends even death and grave, their response was to conspire, to murder. And so, in this story, this episode of the Gospel of John, we find that Lazarus and Martha and Mary have invited Jesus into their home. True to form, Martha is preparing food. True to form, Lazarus is sitting with Jesus, listening to every word that he speaks. True to form, Mary comes into the scene and anoints Jesus, expressing the overflowing outpouring of her love for her Lord. Traditionally, many a sermon's been preached on the Martha-Mary controversy. You remember that other story? Martha comes to Jesus and says, "Tell my sister to get busy and come help me. There's a lot to do." And Jesus says, "Oh, Martha, Martha, Martha." Kind of like Marsha, 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 I guess. Mary has chosen the better portion. But in this particular vignette, what I would suggest to you is that that we see in these three persons a representation on what deep Christian spirituality looks like. As we seek to follow Jesus, we see in these three persons three crucial aspects to how we should follow Jesus. From Martha, we see the doer, the one who performs acts of mercy, the doer who gets out there and gets things done to the glory of God. In Lazarus, we see the one who sits and listens attentively to the words that Jesus speaks, who wants to grow in his cognitive faith, who wants to understand the doctrine and the intricacy of what Jesus stands for and teaches and is all about. And in Mary, oh Mary, we see the outpouring of love and devotion for her Lord. We see her tenderness in her relationship to Jesus Christ. In this family, which is now touched by new life, restored life, there is the doing of acts of mercy. There is attention to the doctrine and teaching of Jesus. There is an outpouring of tenderness and of love. That, my friends, is the Christian life. Mary comes to her Lord with basically a pint of nard. And seeing him there, she bows down to him and begins to pour the pure nard over his feet and to anoint his feet. She does so because, as a true disciple, with penetrating insight, she gets it. She understands from having sat there before by his feet what he is about. She understands where he's going. She understands that the climax is about to occur with the coming Passover in a week or so. She gets it. She reads the crowd wisely. She understands that the priests are conspiring and that they're going to put him to death. And because she loves him, she begins to prepare his body for burial, so that when it comes upon him quickly, suddenly, in an excruciating manner, he will be prepared, symbolically anointed, claimed, cherished, pouring this ointment out on her Lord. She then drops her hair. She wipes his feet with her hair. Much has been made of this, because for a woman to drop her hair in that culture and in that time suggested that she was a lady of the night. One wouldn't do it. It was not proper. It was unseemly to do such a thing. But that's not what's going on here. I mean, she's in her own home. She's with trusted friends. She's in the presence of her Lord. What she's doing by that act, in my opinion, is that she's demonstrating absolute transparency with Jesus. She's basically saying symbolically that all that I am, I give to you. She's symbolically saying, I am literally letting my hair down with you. You know me through and through, and you love me, and I love you. In response to this tenderness, this seeming extravagance, Judas speaks up. Judas says accusingly, why are you letting her do this? That could have been sold, and it was a year's worth of wages. It could be put in the treasury, which I happen to manage. And then it can be used to feed the poor. The author, John, cannot contain himself. In the sixth verse, he adds an editorial comment. Please remember, as you're reading through John, we don't know what happens in Jerusalem yet. We don't know about the startling betrayal yet. But the author can't contain himself. He has to note he said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. The author wants it to be crystal clear, you see, that Judas's motives are not pure. The nard is pure. The word used to describe the ointment that Mary brings is pistiches, from the word pistos, meaning genuine, or more appropriately, faithful. It is nard of faith. And while she is faithful in even this extravagance, Judas's response, while purporting to be of concern for the poor, is anything but faithful. Jesus responds to Judas's accusation. Jesus says, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." What an interesting response Jesus makes. All the other Gospels, in recording the event of his being anointed, disagree in practically every detail with this account, but all agree, save one, that this was the argument that Jesus retorted when she was accused. Why did he refer to this position? What was the argument that he was making? What does it mean to say, "You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me"? Mind that that verse has been misappropriated throughout history to give excuse for inaction regarding the poor. My, how it's been claimed at times to say, "Well, you know, we always have the poor with us. What's a person really going to do?" Jesus is quoting Scripture. Not a surprise, is it? Jesus is quoting Scripture. Jesus knows that he is going to die. And Jesus turns back to Deuteronomy, the 15th chapter. And in noting that we always have the poor with us, Deuteronomy 15 proceeds to say, "So open your hand to the poor, and open your hand to the needy neighbor in your land." The whole point is to say that ordinary business for people of faith is first to be attentive to God and fulfill all religious obligations to God, and then second, to turn your attention to the poor and the needy within your gate. In the Talmud, which is the teaching of Judaism, there was only one exception to this rule of practice. You would always be attentive to God and then be immediately attentive to the poor and needy within your gate. Always, except for one exclusion. Only one thing could possibly trump your attention to the needy and the poor within your gate. You know what that is? Attention to those who die. When faced with a coming death, that took precedence over the poor and the needy within your gate. Jesus is reminding Judas that not only is he insincere, not only is he a thief, not only is he someone who is self-serving all the time, but he's reminding him that he's a lousy theologian.
he doesn't even understand the Talmudic law in which they lived. And Jesus is saying clearly, explicitly to us all, that he knows that as he turns his attention towards Jerusalem, the hour is soon coming for his death. He will be killed because he is the author of life. He will be killed because his words of love fall on hate-filled hearts. He will be killed because he brings people out of death back to life. He will be killed because of his incredible love. He knows this, and still he marches on. He marches on surrounded by a company of faithful who work works of mercy in the kitchen like Martha, who sit attentively to hear his words and integrate them into their lives like Lazarus, and to be adored like Mary. And in Mary's hair, with which she has wiped Jesus' feet, there will be the scent of that love. She marches on with him. Yes, Jesus was going to die, but Mary reminds us there is no waste in love. And when you pour out your hearts, your loving hearts, to Jesus and to one another, there is no waste. Lazarus was raised. The family is whole. Jesus is their Lord. Jesus' love will